Alright, welcome back to another 30-minute session of learning Unity. I think where we last left off is, we were messing with the time, I think. It was in the GameStat script. We created a serializable field, and we made it, and we enforced a rule for the values to only be between 0.1, a floating value, and 10f, or 10 floating value. And essentially during the update, it just sets the time scale, which I believe is a global variable for the whole game. And it seems like it's just setting the value every time, though I feel like that could be a waste. I don't know. I feel like we could if it changed, right? Then we set the value. But if it hasn't changed, then I think we shouldn't be changing the value, because that would be a waste of time, I guess. But since this is just one line, maybe it doesn't. It's not global, and maybe he will go over it. All right. So let's see what we're gonna do next. Oh, wait a minute. So it seems like the only objects that are being affected are those with rigid body. Because our paddle here still moves like this, even if we change the time. We gotta make sure that we changed it. Oh, it's 10. We don't want that. Let's do 0.5. So this is half speed. So if I let go, the rigid body, since ball is the only rigid body, it's only being affected in the time. But the paddle can go as fast as it was, even if it was using the default speed. So we're also gonna prefab the game status. Wait, did that happen to me? I wonder. It happened to me too. It doesn't seem like it. Alright, well. Let's. Yeah, I don't think it happened to us. But I'm kind of curious what his error is. Oh, I see. So his issue was that he's been changing the level object for level 1, but not level 2. So in our level 1, we had to set the scene, right? I can't really tell what his error is, to be honest, but I felt like it has something to do with him not updating the second level, which caused that error. So now that's what he wants us to do, by updating the prefab. They play with the game speed until you're happy with it. Wonder if we could change it to to a speed of 2. Oh. Yeah, that's not good at all. I feel like maybe a speed, I think 1 might be a little bit too fast. So how about 0.75? Nah, it's still kind of slow. Alright, how about 0.85? That's actually not bad. It's not too fast to the point that it's just annoying. Let's continue. Oh, right. So it looks like he didn't have the level. So that was the issue. Ah, gotcha. Alright. He forgot about it. I was wondering, because I did that, and I'm like, wait a minute, didn't he do it as well? But alright, that makes sense. That makes sense. So it looks like it is more optimal to put them all together. So we can change the speed in different levels to kind of throw the player off, maybe. Alright, so the next one will be adding player score. So what he's doing right now is he's setting up the game status to hold or manage our score system. So let's just do this. And he's just doing this to debug the score value to see that it is changing if something does, something bad occurs. Those serialized fields should now appear on the inspector after this is done. So we have the points per block, which we can change, and then we have the current score, which we shouldn't change, considering we want the user to be changing that every time they destroy a block. Oh, so this is our challenge. Alright. So we're gonna need to go to scripts, and then we need to go to the, is it the block or the ball? The block. Right, that makes sense. Alright, so just wanna, so like, I guess the saying is, if the ball gets destroyed, then we need to add to the score. So in our block destroyed method, that would be the perfect place to put it at. So you want to add the points once the object has been destroyed, so you could place it here. You need access to the level, which we already have done over here. So now we're gonna say level dot add to score, and let's go try it out. So we're gonna lock this, and then it hasn't compiled yet. Just all right now. Wait, you got compiler issues. What does it say? Level does not contain definition. All right then. I guess we need to cache the game status too. So let's do that. There you go. Oh, it hasn't compiled yet, so we have to keep trying again. Cool. Alright, we have to look at here. Oh, yeah. Cool. Oh, there it is, and I lost. Oops. All right, let's see what we have to do next. About to be destroyed. Oh, we do have to use it. Cool. I thought I was brute forcing it for a second. Oh. I guess you didn't need the reference. Feeling a progression is what he says. Oh, nice. Looks good. Yeah, we gotta delete that. I don't think it's necessary anymore. Since we don't want the user to just traverse through the levels without actually trying to beat the level. So, yeah, let's delete that. It's in our canvas, which is also not possible. So it says, children of prefab instance cannot be deleted. Oh, I see. So we opened the actual prefab by double clicking on this, and then we took it out. Got it. Alright, cool. I'm gonna do that. Let's see if I still remember about anchoring. So you want to put it at the top right. So now it's in relative to this spot right here. Or in our case, we just anchored it to the top right. So no matter what the screen changes, it'll always be in this position. Looks like we're gonna use fonts again. I always like that because it shows it's like I get to add my own flavor to these tutorials. So let's look for a font. Let's look for, probably gonna go with the generic. Does this have number? Oh, we need to zip it first. Shut down. Now we can. There it is. I guess we didn't really need to zip it. And then we needed to create a atlas for it, I think. So here it is, font asset creator. We gotta do I think that's it. Save. There it is. I think that's how you do it. And then we're just gonna send the font to gameplay. Nice. I think he uses the same one actually. Oh, we have a different.